enormous. So a staff of nurses was put to work making dressings. It seemed incredible that we would ever use as many as we were making, but we took advice of those who knew and kept steadily at it.
3 days after their arrival, 10 of Mary's nurses were reassigned to Base Hospital 18. 22 were sent to a hospital in Paris, and 8 were sent to evacuation hospitals at the front. This left Mary with just 60 nurses to deal with the thousands of patients who would pass through the Base Hospital 42.
By the 15th of August, we had over 500 patients in the hospital, and we were beginning to feel that our usefulness was established. The nurses evinced the greatest amount of interest in their work and vied with each other in making their ward comfortable and ready for operation. We had been at the hospital just a week when we received our first patients, mostly walking cases. A few days later, we received our first convoy of really ill patients when 150 badly gassed cases were admitted to the hospital. It was then that we got our first taste of the horrors of war. These men were suffering acutely, their bodies were badly burned, and their eyes in awful condition. I am proud to be able to say that we did not lose one of these patients.
Nothing could have prepared the nurses for chemical warfare. An invention of World War I, it was insidious, difficult to control, and often fatal.
Our real rush began during the last week of September. We began receiving the sick and wounded in what seemed to be a steady stream. The railroad by which the hospital trains came ran right in front of the hospital. Hardly would we get one convoy settled before we would receive word that another convoy of patients was en route. It was at this time that we found it necessary to open the crisis expansion, which consisted of one tent behind each ward, so that the nursing force of the ward could look after the tent as well. By this time, the climate was beginning to have its effect on some of our members. It rained all the time. The barracks were far from impervious to the weather, and inadequately heated, and a chilly dampness seemed to pervade everything and every place. Nearly all the nurses had bad colds. A few developed pneumonia and influenza.
On September 28th, Mary's assistant, Charlotte Cox, died of acute dysentery. Exhausted and numb, Mary could only manage 3 words on the telegram to Charlotte's family. Charlotte died today.
She was buried on Monday, September 30th, 1918. In the hospital cemetery with military honors, her funeral being attended by all officers, nurses, and enlisted men who could be spared from duty. I can think of no nurse in the unit whose loss could have been more keenly felt. All during the month of October, there were 1,200 to 1,800 patients in the hospital. Many of the patients admitted had been through a first aid station only and came to us still wearing the clothing in which they had been wounded. Most needed immediate operation, and the surgical service became very heavy. The operating room was arranged so that 6 operations could be in progress at once. Unfortunately, the staff of officers had been depleted, as had the nursing staff. It was necessary for nurses and officers to remain on duty for a number of hours far in excess of the number usually allotted. The way in which my nurses arose to the occasion was remarkable, and they are deserving of the greatest praise. Thought of self was put aside, and their devotion to duty was absolute. They gave, not grudgingly, but deeming it a privilege. I feel sure that every one of my nurses feels well repaid for any sacrifice she may have made when she responded so promptly to the country's call for nurses.
I remember this story. Aunt Mary was, in fact, engaged to, I suppose, an officer in the army, and but he was killed. That was the end of everything for her, and she never pursued anybody else.
Guns, the enemy nearly slew ya. Oh, Johnny, led ye to look bad. Johnny, I hardly knew ya. And where are your legs that used to run?
The signing of the armistice came as a wonderful surprise. When we finally received the news that hostilities had ceased that morning, we could hardly grasp its significance. We were in such an out-of-the-way place that we saw very little of the wild enthusiasm and the celebrations that the news of the armistice created throughout France. But even in the little town of Bazois, there was much rejoicing. Lights were lighted for the first time since we had been there. The church bells rang continuously, and the streets were filled with a throng of women and children, their faces beaming with happiness. It was easy to realize their feeling of deliverance from a mighty terror.
World War I was the start of modern warfare. Chemical weapons, aerial assaults, and the submachine gun were all introduced into the world. An entire generation of French, English, and German men was wiped out. It was in this setting that Mary came into her own. She had found her calling.
The nurses were given the privilege of signing for further service in the American Expeditionary Forces. And of the 99 nurses attached to the hospital at that time, 41 signed on for further service. The fact that so many asked to remain should refute for all time the argument that nurses were not properly treated in the AEF. Thus, Base Hospital 42 ceased to exist officially. But the nursing personnel had been a very happy family, and the organization will never cease to exist in our minds and hearts. We came home with the consciousness of work well done, of splendid results achieved in spite of the handicaps met, and of hardships borne uncomplainingly.
No American woman was given a military rank during the war. It wasn't until several years after she returned from France that Mary was given the rank of lieutenant. She stayed with the military for 26 years. She was stationed in New York, D.C., and Puerto Rico. In 1943, she retired as a lieutenant colonel. When asked if she ever wanted to go back to France, Mary would only answer no. She moved back to New York after she retired.
She loved New York, and her apartment was right downtown. Of course, that was years ago, but that's where she wanted to be.
Because I went to see her when she... When I lived in Philadelphia, and I tell you, I couldn't keep up with her for the day. You know, she took you all over town. By the time she got through with you, each time, you know, you were panting. And she was, sat down, had her martini.
Recently, I came across a newspaper article about the retirement party held for Mary. The guest speaker, Colonel Florence Blenchfield, said, "A little nurse once paid the highest tribute in the world to Colonel Mary Gavin. She said, "I don't know how to describe her to you, but I only know that I wish I could grow up to be just like her."
She was an impressive woman. It was sort of throughout the whole family, everybody knew Great Aunt Mary was it, sort of an impressive woman. We had Uncle Frank, but the women liked Great Aunt Mary, don't you think?
Right. Yeah.
Mary died on November 13th, 1968, 50 years and 2 days after armistice was declared in France. I was less than a year old. She is buried in Arlington Cemetery, just behind the tomb of the unknown soldier. Every generation of our family has had a Mary in it. I am the only one left.